Good to be in the house of God, amen. You don't sound too happy, church. Huh? Now, do you know what? I don't like it sometimes when church leaders do that. It's like, you know, it's like trying to stir up an emotional response. But you know what? It's good to be in the house of God, isn't it, this morning? Have people had a good week this morning? A good week this morning? That didn't make sense, did it? You can tell I've not quite woke up on the right side of the bed this morning. But I've had a really, really fantastic week. I'm going to start off with a testimony, right? And then we're going to get straight into worship, because I think it's good, isn't it, just to start off with a story of what God has done, so we can just be like wooed and awed into his presence, amen. So I don't know, some of you who have seen my Facebook account will know about this already, but we've obviously spent a lot of money trying to get the heating fixed, right, since Christmas time. We've probably spent maybe about a grand and a half trying to get the heating fixed, and we've had the heating company back out again this week. And after spending hours on that back heater there, it's now writ off. Yeah, it's not coming back on. So it's been, is it written off or writ off? You can tell I'm from Yorkshire, can't you? And so basically he came back on Friday to cap it off. Now you could look at that and think, well, what a waste of money. We've spent £1,500. We've had the heating working for the Christmas week. And that's it. That's an expensive, you know, Christmas week to have. But you know, something incredible's been happening during this time, which I didn't really know about, and that God's really been working in the gas man. You see, the gas man came in, and if I'm really honest, I kind of judged him in my heart and thought, well, he doesn't look like he'd be interested in God. And do you know what? That's not okay. And I really feel like God's corrected me on that. But Chloe, while I went off to do a meeting somewhere, and Chloe began to speak to this gas man and ask him about his faith and ask him about Jesus. And it turns out that I found out afterwards that he actually had some history in childhood in the Eastern Orthodox Church, the Greek Orthodox Church. So anyway, he's been coming back and forth, and we've been chatting and stuff and, you know, discussing faith. And then it turns out this week that when he came on the final Friday to cap the heater off, that I was doing the lights. I was testing some lights out for some stage lights, and I asked him his opinion. So he was like, yeah, they're not very powerful then. So he said, what I'll do is I'll go to a tool station and I'll buy some LED lights. And what I'll do is I'll buy them, you can test them out, and then we can just give them back and then you can go and get some, because I've got an account for tool station. This guy's got accounts in everything. I think this guy thinks he owns everything. So tool station, right? And then what happens, right, is he comes back here, he fits the lights up, wires the lights up, right? And these LED lights are really bright, right? We know what we're going to do now to get the lighting better in the church, right? They're super bright, they're really cheap. And then he says to me, so what are you going to do then, Steve? Do you want these leaving up for now, or are you going to take them down and put them up later? And I said to him, I says, well, you need to, you know, you need to take them back to the shop, don't you? You know? And he was like, oh, no, Steve, it's all right. If you're going to use them, then you can keep them. And I says, all right, right. I says, gift to the church, is it? And he's like, yeah, you know, gift to the church and that. So he goes downstairs, and then in my head I'm thinking, oh, well, I wonder if he's one of them who thinks that he's earning his salvation by giving a gift to the church. Because, you know, you do get them around, you know. And God's really been correcting me this week, it seems. And then we go downstairs, I start tidying up and that, and I start thinking in my head, man, I've caught the bus to work this week, and I'm here after work, and I'm having to walk home. And I thought it'd be great if I could catch a lift back with him. Anyway, I didn't even have to ask him. He goes, Steve, what are you doing? What are you doing after you finished here? I said, nothing. Why? He says, do you want a lift home? I says, mate, I was just going to ask you that. So anyway, he offers to give me a lift home. We're there. Like, this guy's only supposed to be here for an hour, right? He was here for about 3 hours. And this has been the story, hasn't it, with him? He's always staying here. He won't spend loads of time. So anyway, we end up going out. He ends up going into the van to put his stuff in the van. And I'm walking out of the church, right, with the side door. And as I'm closing the door, I'm thinking, man, I should give him a Bible as a gift from this church. I shut the door and I feel this warmth of that. I feel this real prompting of the Holy Spirit in my stomach right here. And I'm like, oh, no, I've gone now anyway. I've locked up. And then I just stopped and I thought, do you know what? I am not wasting another opportunity for God to move. Because, you know, I've had that before in the past when we've had builders here, and sometimes I felt a prompting and I've not followed it just in case I'm wrong, you know. So anyway, I go back into the church, get the nicest Bible we've got in the office, right, nice polished up thing, Anyway, and I get it and I bring it back out, and I go into the van and I say, you know, mate, I says, have you got a Bible? I said, have you ever read the Bible? He goes, no, I've not got a Bible. He says, I've been wanting to read it actually, Steve. So I says, well, here you go, this is a gift from the church. And man, he was proper moved. He was like, really? And he like holded it and he was like, no one's ever given me a Bible before. And oh, he says, this is really special. He says, I'm going to read this, Steve. I'm going to read it. So anyway, we're driving back down the road. And I says, oh, have you ever given your life to Jesus? And he was like, yeah, I did, you know, when I was a teenager. And then I went off the rails and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then he was like, you know, someone told me, you know, that I couldn't come to Jesus, you know, because the woman I'm living with, I'm not married to. I says, man, I says, forget that. I said, you cannot put an obstacle in front of the gospel. I said, the gospel is come as you are. And he was like, amen, I believe that, Steve. I says, it's come as you are, but Jesus loves you too much to leave you as you are. I said, but it's a journey. So just receive Jesus. Anyway, he's asking me more questions. We're talking and everything like that. And he says to me, Steve, he says, you just put it so simple and so well. He's like, I can understand it, you know, when you tell me about it. So then we pulled up outside my house anyway. I wrote in this Bible for him, from Steve, everything like that. And then I says to him, I says, do you want to give your life to Jesus? And he says, I do, yeah, I think I do, Steve. I think I do. So then he started talking again more. He started chatting and all this stuff. I shared some more testimony with him. I can't remember exactly. He said to me, I don't know what it is, Steve. He said, but I could just feel it coming over me. And he says, you know, I've been doing a lot of soul searching lately, trying to find myself. And he says, and it's like, you know, when I started coming to your church to fix the heating, he says, it's like, you know, it was just like it was meant to be. It's all come at the right time and all this stuff. And I says, yeah, well, I said, mate, I says, you know, God made us, mate. I says, you know, when we come to God, we find ourselves because he made us. And he was like, yeah, and all this lot. And so anyway, I says, so do you want to give your life to Jesus, mate? And he went, I do, Steve, I do. He says, tell me what to say. Tell me what to pray. So I was like, come on, man. And then, you know, I'm an evangelist, as you all know, but I'm not too good at doing this sinner's prayer stuff. I'm not too good at leading people in the sinner's prayer, you know. Mark Greenwood says, you know, you've got to learn how to seal the deal. Well, that's probably one of my weak areas, you know. I'm not very good at personal evangelism one-to-one. Great at preaching the gospel and seeing salvation that way. But this guy is my first person who's got saved on a one-to-one relational thing, you know. So that's a good thing for me. But the thing is, yeah, I prayed for him. Man, he's really touched. You can see the eyes watering. And then I prayed for him. I laid hands on him. He said he could feel, he felt it, and oh man, and everything. And then when I'm getting out of the van, he's like, Steve, if you ever need anything at all, you've got my number. He said, just text me if you need anything with the heating, anything at all. He says, if I'm in the area, he says, I'm on call sometimes on Sundays in Oxford. He says, if I'm in the area, I'm coming to your church. So, because he lives in Buckinghamshire, he lives quite far away. But man, this is what God's doing, amen. And do you know what? The reason why I want to tell you that is to say, let's worship this God together who's saving souls, amen. He's working in our lives. But the reason why I say it as well is, right, is because I judged that man as thinking, when he came in, thinking, oh, he don't look like he'd be interested in Christianity. How wrong am I? Need to repent of that. How often do we do that, thinking, oh, they don't look too open? Meanwhile, my wife there, she's there pursuing it, you know. She's the one who started the conversation. And now this guy is born again. And it's just incredible. We had the joy of the Lord that night, didn't we? Amen. Do you know what? The other thing as well is, right, he's probably not going to become a part of this church. He lives like an hour and a half away. But it's not about that. Amen. It's about discipleship. It's about being missional. It's not about building some big church. Amen. We do want to see a big church. But it's about seeing the kingdom come wherever it is coming. Amen. And that's what we're here for. It's not a church-centric vision. It's a worldwide vision. Amen. And so I'm just going to share a bit of the vision for the church. In fact, we'll do that after worship. Let's get into worship. Let's start. Shall we stand to our feet? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I think I'm going to invite our brother Ash Nixon up to come and pray for us as we enter into a time of worship. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Good morning, everyone. It's an absolute privilege to be here with you today. Always an honor to speak to the people of God. Yes, my name's Ash. I went to Bible College with Steve, which was a few years ago now. So it's beautiful to come here and see him doing all that it is that he trained to do. And it's incredible to see the transformation, the change, and to see so many people coming out to meet with God. So should we pray?
Yeah.
Yeah, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are the Lord of Lords and that you are the King of Kings. We thank you, Lord God, that this isn't a building, this is a people saved by your grace and for your glory. We thank you, Jesus, that you are here, that you are in this house, that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you promise to be there in their midst. So we praise you, Lord, for who you are. And we thank you, Lord, for this man that gave his life to Christ. We pray, Lord God, that you would pursue him, that you would lead him, that you would guide him, that you would help him to settle himself in a local congregation, a place where he could be loved and blessed in Jesus' name, Lord God. So we offer up our praise to you. We offer up our adoration and our worship to you today, King of kings and Lord of lords, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just praise the Lord right where you are. Hallelujah, Lord. You're worthy, Jesus. You're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. The Bible says that we can command our souls to praise the Lord, to bless the Lord. When we don't feel like praising him, we can command our souls. We can say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me, bless his holy name. Why do we bless him? Because he's holy. Why do we bless him? It's because he's righteous. Why do we bless him? Because he's God and he's God alone. Hallelujah. So we just say, bless the Lord, O my soul. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, so bless the Lord.
Worship his holy name.
I lift my hands to God.
Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name.
Hallelujah.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. Yes. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So I command my soul to worship your holy name. I'll sing like never before, sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, hallelujah. Worship his holy name. Freedom in this place, so sing like never before. Hallelujah. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. Because you're worthy. I will worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. We will worship your holy name. We have to worship you. We will worship you, oh God, yeah. We will worship you, oh God, yeah. We will worship you, oh God. You've been too good. You are too good not to worship you. I have to worship you, oh God, yeah. I'll sing like never before. I'll sing like never before. There is freedom in this place. You can sing like never before. You can sing like never before. You can sing like never before. Cause there is freedom in this place. Come and sing like never before. Sing like never before. Sing like never before. There is freedom in this place. There is hope in this place. There is freedom in this place. The power of God is in this place. The power of God is in this place. The power of God. Yay. We'll sing like never before, yeah. You've been too good, yeah. If anyone wants to pray out, feel free. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Freedom. Singing like never before. We will bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Sing like never before. Sing out to God. Sing like never before. Whatever's on your heart. Sing like never before. We will bless the Lord. We will bless the Lord. Sing like never before. Sing like never before. Sing like never before. We will bless the Lord, we will bless the Lord, yeah. Hallelujah. Lord, you're worthy.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. We will worship your holy name. As a family, we will. We will worship your holy name. We're one in Christ. So we will worship your holy name. We're together in God. So we will worship your holy name. We will worship your holy name.
My soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art!
Yes, you are Lord.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! O Lord my God, when I awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand hath made. I see the stars, I hear a roaring thunder.
Soul.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art!
To you alone.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, tell thee, Lord, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is Son, not sparing
for you and me,
sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God.
God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Oh, for your glory, Lord. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I'll lie back in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Yes, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, oh, to you, Lord. How great thou art. How great thou art. You worthy, Lord. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Let's sing that again. Then sings my soul. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee is full of my heart. How great thou art. How great thou art. Let every tongue confess. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Oh, how great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art, you worthy God. How great thou art. How great thou
is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your heart. bread. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. I'm lost. I'm lost without you. I'm desperate for you. We're lost without you. Before you, Jesus, and I'm lost without you.
We're lost without you. It's
family. We're lost without you. We're lost. Jesus, we're lost without you.
Is the cry of our heart this morning, Lord, that we're desperate for you, Father. Hungry for you, thirsty for you, Lord. Lost without you, Father. It's you in whom we live, move, and have our being, God. We find ourselves, Lord, when we find you, because you are the one who formed us. You are the one who made us, Lord. We've been made in the image of God. If you want to know your destiny today, get to know Jesus Christ. If you want to know your purpose today, if you want to know who you are today, if you want to figure out how you work as a human being, get to know Jesus Christ. He'll be able to tell you better than any psychologist, any doctor. He is the great physician, amen? I'm not supposed to be preaching, I'm supposed to be praying. Father, we declare your glory this morning. We worship you, we praise you, we magnify your name, and we exalt you, Lord. And we invite you into this space, Holy Spirit, to come and do what only you can do. Lord, for those areas of our lives, Lord, that are not hungry for you. Maybe there's some of us this morning, we're not feeling hungry, we're not feeling desperate. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would awaken a hunger and a thirst. Because the hunger and thirst is the greatest gift we can receive from God. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to invite people to come up in a moment and share a testimony of maybe there's a way this week that God's been showing up and showing off in your life, yeah? It's good to hear testimonies, isn't it? About what God is doing in the 21st century. We've read loads of stories about what God has done in the first century and before Christ in the Old Testament, yeah? Thousands of years ago. We've heard great testimonies about what God has done in past decades and past centuries. But do you know what? I believe God is still moving today. Amen. A lot of people think God's given up on the church, that the church is in decline. And you know what? The statistics might show that. But I believe God is still working with those who are faithful to him. Amen. And so we're going to open up this space for you to come and share a testimony this morning. And why you think about that, because, you know, I know that we're often catching people off guard with that. I'm just going to share a bit of vision, amen, because I notice we've got some new people in the house this morning. So this church that you're here today is Restoration Church, amen. I mean, I'm sure, hallelujah, yeah. If you want to get the picture, bro, thank you. Restoration Church. I'm assuming you know that. I don't want to insult your intelligence. You've probably seen it on the website or on the internet. I'm sure we can all read, and if we can't, that's good, because, you know, praise God. You know, God can speak to anyone. It doesn't matter how intellectual you are, how educated you are. God is for everyone. The gospel is for everyone. Amen. It's not discriminatory. But what is Restoration Church? Well, our vision and our mission is to reach out and lift up. Hallelujah. And you know what that means? Well, there's three applications to that vision, three ways that this vision manifests. or what we're praying and dreaming for it to manifest, right? And the first is, we have a heart to reach out and to lift up the lost, marginalized, and broken in our society, in Oxford, in Britain, and beyond. We just happen to be starting in Oxford. We believe in a God who stoops down and lifts up the broken out of the miry bog, the Bible says. He's a compassionate God. And so on the conviction of that scripture, our heart and our mission is to reach out to people and give them a leg up in life, helping them to be all that they were created to be, helping them live the life that God intended them to live. We want to help them in society. We want to help people be better people, better image bearers of God, amen. But we also want to see people saved, hallelujah. And that is the second part of this mission. You see, in Romans 15, the Apostle Paul talks about his missionary work, his ministry to the Gentiles, to the surrounding nations, as a priestly ministry. In other words, he saw his ministry as preaching to the Gentiles, Christ crucified, as though he was lifting them up, back up to God as a restored humanity, a renewed humanity. Yeah? It's a priestly ministry. The work of evangelism is a priestly ministry. We are a priestly church. This is a priestly vision. And hear me when I say that. I don't mean that I'm the priest and I'm giving communion and I'm saying, bless you, free Hail Marys, and that's it. Your sins are forgiven, off you go. Because do you know what? That's quite heretical, actually. There's only one who forgives sin. His name is Jesus Christ. There's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. But do you know what it is, yeah? This is a priestly vision, right? Because all of you are priests. We're all called to be priests. We're all called to bring all of creation, God's temple of creation, back under his lordship, reign, and rule. And that's what our mission is. That's what evangelism is. That's what the work of being a missional church is, to declare the rule and reign to the whole of creation. And that really leads me on to the third and final aspect of this vision. Reaching out and lifting up, not just souls, not just hearts, not just people, because that's quite, you know, we need to go further than that. We want to reach out and lift up all areas of life and society back up to God. You see, this nation has been really blessed by the biblical Christian worldview. This nation has been a breeding ground for the kingdom of God, amen? Yeah, it wasn't without its errors and its faults, just like no church is without its faults. You know, we live in a fallen world and we're all on a journey to glory, amen. We all need the grace of God. But this nation has been truly blessed and impacted by the gospel. No one can deny that, right? But we're seeing a real move away from God in this nation, right, yeah? Our laws are becoming anti-Christian. We're falling in love with death and murder through abortion, euthanasia, assisted suicide, whatever it is. We love death, right? But I believe that God is not finished with this nation. And I believe that we can change this nation. I believe that God has positioned us in such a place as Oxford, an influential city where the next politicians are studying, the next biologists are studying, the next journalists are studying, you name it. They're all here. They're all here studying, and they're all going to be the next generation of leaders and innovators for our nation. Our heart and mission in this position that God has called us in is to reach out and lift up all areas of life and society back up to Jesus Christ. What does that look like? Well, it looks like this. We want to see Christian politicians go into the House of Parliament. We want to see Christian scientists do biology and chemistry. We want to see Christian solicitors, Christian healthcare professionals. I mean, what would it look like if the NHS was operating on Christian foundations and principles? Amen. Amen. We might actually be saving lives rather than aborting them, yeah? Just saying, a bit controversial, but, you know, it is what it is. It's truth. And do you know what? That's one thing you're going to get at this church. Truth, yeah? We want to speak the truth. We want to speak it in love. And so our vision and mission is to see this nation turn back to God. You know what? Some people, I think, have found it a little bit hard to understand this vision. I mean, we were talking to David just a few weeks ago, and, you know, they were talking about how they do some entrepreneurial work, right? Really, really inspiring stuff, like really amazing, yeah? Some of you are probably thinking, well, what's that going to do with Christianity, you know? We, it's about going to heaven, Christianity, right? Well, what would it look like if we were to raise up entrepreneurs for the kingdom of God? And I don't mean a church-centric, let's go and plant loads of churches, because that's often what we equate entrepreneurial with, planting churches. No, I'm on about entrepreneurs in the marketplace, yeah? What would it look like for Christian economists to be going out there and showing people how to make money God's way? Hallelujah. bringing all areas of life and thought back into conformity with Christ, what would it look like for us to be making money, being entrepreneurs in a kingdom way? What would it look like if we were to put on some training course here, I'm just thinking out loud here, teaching people how to make money, teaching people how to be entrepreneurs, teaching people how to fix cars, free of charge, all in a way that is following the Bible, the consistent way. Do you know what I mean? This is what we need in our nation right now. The Bible has the answers to every issue in our society, and we need to be speaking that out, and we need to be influencing. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, well, Stephen, this is quite a big vision. Like, how are you going to see that happen? You're talking about changing a nation here. Well, do you know what? I look up in the Bible and I see Gideon, you know, he had 300 men. I see God using 12 ordinary men to tip the world upside down. And I think, I don't know, we've probably got about 35 in here. I think we're doing all right. I think we're all right. It's not 12, it's 35. And do you know what? God can use your little and do great things with it. He can bring great increase. If you just bring a mustard seed, he'll grow a massive tree. Yeah? This is the God who we serve. And so our vision and mission is your vision. I want to say to you today, the vision of Restoration Church is your vision. What is your vision? What is your goal in life? What is your dream? What do you want to do? And maybe you're studying now. What profession do you want to go into? What do you want to do right now? What are you dreaming of? What are your aspirations? I want to say to you that that vision is our vision, because we believe God has put the desires of your heart in your heart, and that he wants to use it to forward his kingdom. And so we're not talking here about just getting people to heaven, but we're talking about bringing heaven to earth. Amen. And not just through encountering the Holy Spirit in a nice emotional way, which is amazing. We need that, absolutely. We need the joy of the Lord, amen. But we want to see justice in our nation. We want to see God's principles and God's laws established in the earth so that this nation can prosper and begin to bless other nations once again, like it did in the past. And do you know what? I think that when we see the next rise of Christianity in this nation, it's going to be greater than ever. We're not going to have slavery. We're not going to have all those negative things because they've already been called out, amen. So let's believe God for better. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to invite Ash Nixon up. But before we do that, I just want to read a bit of scripture just to encourage us, really, on this journey through the attributes of God. I feel like it's a really nice break this morning to have Ash with us, because Ash is a very practical guy. So, you know, we're not just going to be getting a teaching on the attributes of God this morning, but we really believe that we're going to be experiencing the power of God. Because I believe that the power of God is best learnt when it's experienced. Hallelujah. So a short encouragement here. From Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. You don't need to go there in your Bibles, but you can if you wish to. I'm not glitching maybe 2 seconds. This is what the Apostle Paul writes to the Ephesian, the church at Ephesus. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love towards all of the saints, someone needs to take that, all of his saints are loved, amen, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe. Short thing there from that, a couple of truths there, right? The attributes of God, the study of the intrinsic values and characteristics of God is really, really important for those of us who believe in Jesus Christ and are walking with him, simply because Christianity is a journey, right? Our whole faith is about growing to know God more and more. And do you know what? Sometimes we forget who God is when we're going through dark times in our lives. It's then when we need to cling to the characteristics of God. This is who my God is. Amen. He will never leave me nor forsake me. We need our eyes opening, the eyes of our hearts. So as we continue through this series, I would just encourage you, pray that God would reveal something fresh in your heart about who he is as we go through this series. You see, the attributes of God is not an intellectual exercise. You can't just read a few books and think, man, that's it, I know God. You need to know him in your heart. It's then when the truth sets us free and we are empowered to do great exploits. And I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to invite Ash to come up, because it says here in this text that when we get to know the knowledge of God and the wisdom of God by revelation, that he'll make known his great power to those of us who believe. So without further ado, Ash, if you want to come up, brother, very welcome here. Give him a clap, guys. Make him feel welcome. A good friend of mine at Bible College. It's a privilege, bro, to have you here and come and share.
Bless you, guys. I need a bit of space. I'm a bit of a mover. Is that all right? Come on. Should we start in prayer together, yeah? Father God, my Lord, what a task. What a mission, Lord God. What an assignment to declare the power of God, to reveal something of your nature to your people in your house, Lord God. And so we just pray and ask now in Jesus' name that you would flood this house with your presence, Lord. That you let a sense of your presence be known in this place. Would you increase, Lord God, our awareness of your anointing? Would you increase, Lord God, within us now an awareness of the faith that leads us to salvation, that leads us to believing in the tangible manifestation of your Holy Spirit? Holy Father, living God, would you move in this place, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The power of God, eh? What a topic. I mean, I remember, like, a long time ago when I first started to see God truly moving. Like, it was inspiring. Like, you know, you read it and you believe it and you come to faith, but then you see him moving and you're like, oh my days, God's real. And again and again and again, he wells you and he astounds you and he reminds you of just how magnificent and holy and powerful and pure and true he really is. Back in my home church, back in the city centre of Birmingham, we used to take out an entire evangelism team, a missional team out into the city centre. We'd have a live band and dance teams and teams, and people would share testimonies and preach the gospel. And I remember as we gathered the people, hundreds of people began to gather. They began to flock together and choruses were ringing out. The worship was being praised in the city centre of Birmingham. And this woman came with her husband in a wheelchair. And instantly you start to think, have I got the faith? Have I got the faith to believe? Afterwards, I spoke to this lady. Actually, she had the ability to walk. She had the capacity to move. But she had a degenerative muscular disease, which meant that every spasm of her body, every contraction, was excruciatingly painful. She hadn't been able to walk freely for decades. Her and her husband had struggled on with this degenerative disease that slowly confined her to a wheelchair in agony and pain every time she moved. She didn't know God until that day. And anyway, as the worship rang out and I'm there wondering if I had the faith to go and pray for her, all of a sudden I just began to see this smile across her face. All of a sudden she began to stand up and to rise from her wheelchair. Her husband, almost shocked and amazed at what was going on, taking her by the hand. And as she began to walk and move, as her joints began to straighten up, as she began to move, she began to feel more free and more at ease. And before long, her and her husband were dancing around and they were praising God. Nobody prayed for her. The presence of God fell in power and she began to move. Afterwards, when I spoke to her, I said, what happened? She said, I have no idea. All I felt was this overwhelming sense of love. This overwhelming sense that something was happening in the center of my inner being. And she said, this joy overwhelmed me to the point I had to dance. I had to sing. And she said, I felt no pain whatsoever. Me and my husband, we've not danced together for 20 years. That's the power of our God. That's the God that we serve. We preach the love of Christ crucified. We preach about God who came to save this world. But it's the power of God that lets us know that that love is true, that it's alive, and that it's living. I remember another time being in a service, and me and my friend were there. Do you remember Vernon from Bible College, Steve? Yeah. Vernon was a guy from Bible College, and he had cataracts. He was an older student, and cataracts, for those of you that don't know, it's like a layer of skin, a bit of a film that grows across your eyes, and it thickens over time, and it impairs your vision. Well, he's at Bible College, right? Studying books and reading and writing papers, and his studies were being affected. The NHS is incredible, right? And they have a procedure where they pop the eye out the socket, they cleanse the lens and pop it back in. But the waiting times, they're quite long. They're quite a long time, and his studies were being impacted. I remember being in a service, and there was a few thousand of us at the regional conference that happens, and we're all praising God. The presence is tangible. God's amongst his people. There are fits of laughter breaking out in one corner of the room. Somewhere else, there's people weeping and crying. People are falling under the Spirit. God's at work and he's moving in power. My friend told me afterwards that he remembers standing there and just giving glory to God. Amongst all of these people, he found himself completely alone with Jesus, praising the Lord, giving him glory, giving him praise. And then as the song changed, he opened his eyes to see what the next song was. And all of a sudden, he had 20/20 vision. Nobody prayed for him. Nobody laid hands on him. The power of God met with him, and his father reminded him that I love you, and I see you, and I care for you, and I want the very, very best for you. That father and that God is in the house today. He is here moving amongst us. He sees your difficulties. He sees your trauma. He sees your pain. He sees what it is that you're going through in life, and he cares. He cares so much so that he presences himself amongst us and moves in power and reveals himself to us. And if for a moment you will allow yourselves to believe, if you'll allow God to allow faith to rise from within, I believe that you will meet with God today in an incredibly powerful way. We begin our journey today looking at an incredible passage written by the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul is writing a letter to a church that he'd planted in Corinth. And this letter has been seen by the people who established the Bible as being inspired by God. This letter has found its way into Holy Scripture. This is a reflection from Paul as he talks about the disciples that he'd met there and the church that he'd planted. And he reminds them of how they came to faith. And when I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come to you proclaiming the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. And my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstrations of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. It is my hope and prayer today that you do not come here to listen to some theological argumentation, some rhetorical words that are spoken, some wise words that have been crafted on a piece of paper, but that you would meet with God in power, in spirit, and in truth. There will be an invitation at the end of this service to meet with God from the comforts of your own chairs, whether it's at the front, however God's going to lead us. I'm not going to prescribe how God's going to move. All I'm here to do is to encourage you to believe, to trust that something magnificent is going to happen today, to believe that you're going to meet with God. And then I just want to pause and wait and let God be God and do what only God can do. Amen? Amen. Praise God, eh? Amen. Come on. He's worth it, isn't he? He's an incredible God. He really is. The words of Jesus, they cry out from Scripture, right? This is why the signs come. This is why the miracles take place. Jesus calls out to every one of you here today, come to me. Come to me, all of you here today who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. These are the words of Jesus Christ. This is the invitation of Holy Scripture. Come to me, says the Lord Jesus Christ. I promise I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, says the Lord, and learn from me. For he is gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Holy Father, Lord God, we just want to recognize your presence in this house right now. We want to recognize, Lord God, that when you move in power, that when you rest upon a people, it's not about the signs and the wonders. It's not about the show. It's about your love being made manifest for your people. It's about your invitation to journey with you in the journey of grace, Lord God, to partner with you in life and to walk through this world with you as their Lord and their Savior. We praise you, God. Would you release your kingdom into this place? In Jesus' name, amen. And so we're looking at the power of God, right? The entirety of Holy Scripture is permeated with the power of God. I would argue that every other attribute of God means nothing and is insignificant without the power of God. Let's think about it. God's gracious, right? And he wants to give us good gifts. But if he didn't have the power to do that, his grace would be insufficient. He's a merciful God, right? And mercy means that he's not going to judge us and he's not going to punish us for what our sins deserve. But if he didn't have the power to hold us to account, then his mercy would be irrelevant, right? And so the power of God permeates every fiber and essence of Scripture. All that God is the rawest and most purest form of pure power. From the beginning to the end, from the first to the last, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who was and is to come. He is here and he is amongst us today. Jesus being the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. The God of Holy Scripture is here and he's in the house. So let's begin our journey right at the very beginning, right? The beginning of beginnings. The word declares that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. I want you just to imagine that just for a moment. That in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now this word earth here in the Hebrew, in our Bibles, it deposits everything that was ever known by the Hebrew mindset, from the smallest particles, from the smallest atoms, from the smallest dust molecules that they understood, which covers our atoms and molecules, the periodic table, everything that has ever been created and brought into existence. God himself fashioned it and he formed it. From the dust that's on our ground now, Steve was here last night hoovering the floor, so I'm sure it's perfectly fine. But from the dust molecules on the carpet that are here to the farthest flung galaxy in the known universe, God created it. I'm talking about a God who is powerful enough from nothing to bring into existence everything that you've ever seen, everything you've ever perceived, everything you've ever conceived in your own mind. God has brought that into being. But beyond that, beyond the physical, God has also birthed the spiritual, the heavens, everything that is supernatural, everything that exists beyond empirical evidence, everything that exists beyond what science can measure, God has created that also. We recognize the supernatural. We recognize witchcraft. We recognize clairvoyancy. We recognize all of these things because God has brought into being the supernatural. Now, unfortunately, that which is wicked has manipulated it and twisted it and contorted it. But nonetheless, my God created it. My God is in complete control. So when I talk about the power of God, I'm not talking about a fluffy feeling on a Sunday morning. I'm talking about the creator and the sustainer of all life on earth. It's at this point that people often say to me, well, who created God? If God created all this, who created God, right? And that's one of the most beautiful things right here in the very first few words. In the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. The beginning of what? The beginning of beginnings. God was already there. At the dawn of time and eternity itself, God already was. God himself fashioned and created time. Now this is hard for us to comprehend, right? I am born, I live, I die. I wake up, I go through my day, and my day comes to an end. I start a course of study, I go through the course, and it finishes. Everything that I know is chronological. Beginning, middle, end, beginning, middle, end. I cannot comprehend life outside of time. Yet my God is outside of time. He himself created time. And so if he created time, he is not bound by the limits of time. If he's not bound by the limits of time, then he stands outside of it. Neither having a beginning, a middle, or an end. This is an eternal God who always has been and always will be. And when I talk about the power of God, I'm talking about a God who created everything that we can even conceive. Everything that you've ever studied at university, everything you've ever studied at school, God created it and fashioned it, and he knows it inside and out. And his power is in this house today. God is amongst us. It's at this point people say to me, well, what about the Big Bang, right? Surely the Big Bang and all of the science and all of the theories and the understanding, cosmic inflation, for those of you that have heard the term, what about the discovery of the cosmic microwave background radiation? These are nice scientific terms which posit the Big Bang theory. Scientific evidence that points to the beginning of time, to the dawn of existence itself, to this theory that they believe is where how the whole of the universe came into being. My Bible simply says this, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. My God spoke all of creation into being, and the greatest cosmic inflation, the greatest explosion of all time took place as God created the universe. He flung the stars into space. I promise you, here and now, any scientific discovery will always prove that this is true. Always. There is no odds between science and God. There is no discoveries within the scientific realm that disproves this. This is true. It is alive and it is living. They've only discovered this in the last 100 years. It's been written for thousands of years in scripture. But rather than humbling themselves and recognizing that actually the Bible got it right, they come up with some theory that some atoms and molecules rubbed together and everything came out of nothing. I mean, to believe that, you must be pretty crazy, right? Oh my days. There is a created order. Everything you look at, it's fashioned, it's designed, it's crafted, it's created. My God has the power to establish everything. And he's here. He's moving amongst us. This is the beautiful bit I love about the gospel, though. It goes on to say, and God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. The gospel contained in the very first words of Holy Scripture, God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. In Holy Scripture, light is a metaphor for everything that is good and pure and holy and true and good. Darkness itself, again, a metaphor for that which is evil and broken. The pain and the suffering and the angst and the anxiety and the fear and the depression of this life and of this world. The pain and the suffering that exists in our species. And God has the power to separate the light from the dark. Let me ask you today, what darkness is there that exists within you? What darkness is there that exists in your environment, in your circumstances, in your home, in your workplace, in your family, in your school, in your university, wherever it is that you live and move and have your being? What darkness exists within you? What depression, what brokenness, what sickness, what disease exists within you? Because my God has the power to separate the light from the dark. Our God is here and He's alive. Amen. Let's praise Him. Let's praise Him, for He's worthy of it, right? He is so worthy. And so again, God calls out to you here today. Come to me, all of you here today who are weary and heavy laden. You know what I'm saying, right? Those of you that are weary and heavy laden, those of you who recognize the darkness that is sometimes so palpable in our existence, come to me, says Jesus. Stop fighting along on your own. Stop trying to do life without me. I'm here, I'm calling out to you. Come home to me. I am your God, I am your Savior, I am the light of the world, and I will shine into the darkness of your human heart, and I will illuminate Christ Jesus to you. Come to me, says Jesus Christ. Come home to your Father in heaven. Come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will take that darkness away and give you rest. The invitation of Christ Jesus from the book of Matthew, crying out in unison with what is written in the book of Genesis. I remember one time going to a youth conference, me and my wife. I should have warned you, I'm going to share this story. And we went to a youth conference, and I'd just finished Bible college, and we were due to take a stand with us to promote the Bible college. And me and my wife were in a bit of a dark place at the time. We hadn't long been married, and you know, before I got married, I thought I was pretty selfless. I was doing quite good as a Christian, right? And then I got right married and realized just how selfish I really was, you know? Like, sanctification happens in relationships, doesn't it, right? But anyway, we're on the way to this conference and we're in a bit of a broken, bad place. I think we argued the whole way there. We were upset, we were frustrated. We set up this stand and we went to this worship service, and there was thousands of kids in there. Like, they were worshiping, they were going crazy. God, the tangible presence of God was all over that place. It was incredible. I was feeling nothing. Angry, frustrated, in a dark place spiritually. I don't even remember, like forgive me for this. I stood before them, I said, Lord, I am not worshipping you today. I was not in a good place. I was frustrated, I was upset, I was angry. The darkness had closed in, right? The darkness had clouded his face. I couldn't see him through my own brokenness at that moment. But as I just stood there, all of a sudden, I felt something. It was real gentle. And by this point in my journey, I'd come to recognize the presence of God. And sometimes he will begin just like that, just soft, just gentle, like a gentleman, just letting you know he's there. And as I felt his presence, as I just felt this softness, I just said, Lord, is that you? And all of a sudden, just wave after wave of the love of God just crashed upon me. No judgment, no hardship, no hatred, no anger, no judgment, no get on your knees because of your sins. And I just fell on my face. I fell on my knees, weeping and crying and bawling as my Father met with me in power. That is our God. That is our Lord. I think I'm a little bit better as a husband now, am I? Getting there, yeah? But this is our God, right? He meets with us in our brokenness. He meets with us in our darkness. He meets with us in our despair. And he separates the light from the dark. Holy Father, Lord God, right now we recognize that you are perfection, that you are pure brilliance, that you are light and exaltation, that you are beautiful and pure and holy. And so, my Lord God, right now we recognize that we fight not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and the powers in the unseen world. And, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ now, we speak to those powers. We speak to the darkness that is in this house. We speak to the brokenness that exists in this space. And we say, be gone right now in Jesus' name. The power of God is upon us. The Spirit of the living God is within this place. We remind you right now that it is finished. Be gone in Jesus' name. Holy Father, would you come now and fill this space? Wherever the darkness has fled, Lord God, would you inhabit that space? Right here, right now, would you increase the sense of your presence in this house? Would you take up residence in this place? God, we recognize that only you can save souls, only you can redeem and heal and set free. So would you move in power, please, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. He's good, isn't he, man? I love this. It's such a blessed topic, like. However, we've got to cover the whole counsel of God, right? You ever heard that term before? Ever heard that term? So we as Christians, especially in the 21st generation, we love to cherry pick the elements of God that we like the look of. And we like to cherry pick the bits of him that we think are nice and fluffy that we like to hold on to. And sometimes we ignore other parts of him. Oftentimes because we don't understand. We haven't quite grasped it. And so because we don't quite grasp it and it doesn't quite fit with what we want a God to look like, we ignore it and we walk away from it. But once you grasp it fully and truly understand the entirety of God's nature and his character, not that I believe that any of us could ever truly do that here on the face of the earth, you will love him all the more and you will understand him all the more. And his power will work incredibly through this generation. Our God is a good God, right? And so I want to talk to you now about the power of the judge. We've looked at the power of the creator, which talks about the fatherhood of God. But what about the power of the judge? The one who must judge sin. The one who must deal with the darkness. You see, my Bible declares that at the end of days, God will fold up all of creation like a garment. He will pass it through the flames, and behold, all things will be made new. Can you just grasp that for a moment? We've talked about a God who flung the galaxies into space, who created the cosmos, a God who set every solar system into its orbit, and yet, at the end of days, he declares he will fold it up upon itself. He will pass it through the flames. A picture of purification, of sanctification, of refining, of removing the stubble, of removing that which is barren, getting rid of the death and the destruction, the pain and the suffering. The Bible declares that in the new world and in the new heaven and in the new earth, there'll be no suffering, there'll be no pain, there'll be no sickness, there'll be no disease, there will be perfection on the face of the earth. You can even begin to contemplate the power and the majesty of such a God. It's at this point that a lot of people, they mock the Christian belief in the apocalyptic end to humanity. The scientific communities, atheists alike, they look out at this universe and think about how vast and how majestic and how powerful and how majestic are you. It's like, universe is beautiful, right? And it's huge. How can anything or any being bring any of that to a close? Surely you Christians, you've lost your mind. You're lost in your own imagination. How can you believe in such nonsense? But this is what the word declares, speaking about such people. For they deliberately overlook this fact, that the heavens existed long ago and the earth was formed out of the water, through the water, by the word of God. You might just read over that and think, what's that going to do with what we're talking about? For they deliberately overlook this fact. It's now a fact that the universe was created, right? But 150 years ago, the scientific community, academics and atheists alike, again, they looked out at the universe and they said, this universe has always been here. Nobody's created this. It's too big. It's too vast. And the same arguments that they now use to declare that the end of the universe ain't going to happen, they used to declare because the universe never came into being. They declared it wasn't created. It's always been here. They said, Christians, you're stupid. God created. This universe has always been here. And then the Hubble telescope came across. And they discovered that the universe was expanding still. That from that very first word that God spoke, the universe is still expanding. It's still growing. His creative force is still expressing itself. All these years, however many years you believe it might have been, God is still expanding our universe and growing. And so the word declares that by this very same word, the heavens and the earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. These are elements of the Bible we don't often like to read, aren't they? But God is a judge. God will bring about the destruction of our known universe, that at the end of days he will hold us all account for the ways that we have lived our lives. The Bible declares that at the end of days every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess the lordship of Jesus Christ. On that great day, there'll be two types of people. Those who fall to their knees in praise and adoration and exaltation of their God, so thankful that their Savior has returned. And the other group, which I'm fearful for, will fall to their knees in anger and frustration and bitterness and brokenness, realizing that their moment of repentance has passed. And now that all that lies ahead is their moment of judgment. It's a terrifying aspect of the Bible. It's a fearful aspect of the Bible. But over and over again, this reinforcement comes across. Over and over again. But do not overlook this fact. Another fact for you here and now today, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is 1,000 years. And 1,000 years are as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some of you count slowness, but he is patient towards you. God doesn't want to judge. God doesn't want to send people to hell. He's not that kind of a God. Don't think that God is an angry tyrant up there counting your sins and counting your good deeds and waiting to punish you. God's a God who's slow and he's patient. He's longing for you to come home. He's yearning for you to come. And he's crying out to you. Evidence of his existence is all around us. The Bible declares that all of creation gives glory to God. That the whole of creation points to the existence of a God. We have churches in every town and village. We have the Quran. The Quran preaches Jesus Christ. You can preach the gospel from the Quran if you care to read it. But Muslims, they don't read it. There is evidence, and there is evidence for the existence of God throughout the known universe. His invitation is there. He is patient towards us, longing for us to come home, yearning for us to accept his invitation to life and life everlasting. But it reminds us that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, and the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. It's a fearful thing, the Bible declares, to fall into the hands of the living God, to refuse his invitation to life and life everlasting. But yet the Bible declares, doesn't it, in one of our most favorite verses, that God so loved the world. He's a loving God. He's not an angry tyrant. He's not a fierce judge. He doesn't want to destroy. He loves this world so much so that he has given his son, his one and only son, so that whomsoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but receive everlasting life. You see, it is the very power of God that should produce within us the fear of God. You see, the power of God is not just an expression of who God is or an outworking of his existence, but is the very essence and substance of who he is. God is the purest and rawest form of holy power. Let me just pause just for a moment, because it's a hard thing to try and teach on, is the fear of God. But let me just imagine now for a moment, this is the middle of the night. It's pitch black outside and we turned off the lights. What would it be like in here? Pitch black and dark, right? We'd get up from our seats and we'd bump into one another. We'd clamber over each other. We'd harm one another and hurt one another. We'd try and get to the toilets and we'd get angry and frustrated that we couldn't find our way. We'd look for the door and we'd all try and tram through, and none of us would have a clue what was going on. Harm and hurt and pain and suffering would be taking place, right? But God is the light. And then imagine the spotlight suddenly shone. Boom! The darkness disappears, right? And then we're all exposed because we've just clambered over each other. We've just got frustrated with one another. And then we begin to realize that actually the darkest thing in existence isn't the night. It's not the absence of light. The darkest thing in existence is my heart. It's the brokenness that exists within me. And if I'm going to come into the presence of Almighty God and be with him in all of eternity, I better hope that darkness is gone, because that light will shock me, it will shake me, it will dissolve me, it will frustrate me. I can't exist with God unless his light exists within me. This is what the Bible declares, that for those who put their trust and their faith in Jesus Christ, he himself, by the power of his Holy Spirit, will come to live within you, that his light will shine from within. Jesus said, whoever believes in me, from out of their hearts will flow rivers of living water. The very life essence of Almighty God will come to live within you, transforming in you, changing you from the inside out. And so we see in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, before the coming of Jesus, this struggle between God and humanity. They struggled to coexist. God himself longing for relationship, longing to reach out to his creation, but us holding on to the darkness, holding on to the brokenness, creating this void, this barrier, this separation called sin, stopping us from getting close to Almighty God. We see in the story of Job, a righteous man in God's sight, but a man who fell into pain and suffering. He spends over 30 chapters wallowing in his despair, arguing with his friends about the existence of God and the goodness of God. And all of a sudden, a whirlwind tears through the atmosphere. And from out of the whirlwind, God speaks. Whenever God arrives, he arrives in power and in majesty and holy splendor. His creation bowing before him. He himself, powerful and majestic, is who he is. Yet he wants his power inside of you. He wants you to share with him of his essence, for you to become one with him as he becomes one with you. Another time, the priests had completely cleansed the temple. They purified it. They'd done everything they could physically to make this place holy and pure. And the glory cloud of the Lord fell. The glory cloud of the Lord filled that space so much so the priests couldn't even minister. When God tries to coexist with his people apart from the cross of Christ Jesus, it's impossible. Human-made religion, man's thoughts, is all the psychology, the philosophy, and all the religions of the world are constantly trying to get to God. You can't get to God. God has come to us. God has revealed himself to us in the person of Jesus Christ, and to accept him is to accept life itself. There's another incredible encounter. I'm going to read this one for you because I love these words. God said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by and a great strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his cloak around his face and he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. When God rocks up and he turns up, the rocks crumble. The wind blows. The fires blaze. People begin to cry. People begin to laugh hysterically. People fall down under the presence of Almighty God. Do not be distracted by the signs and the wonders, but learn to attune yourself to the sound of that still, small voice. Allow his invitations and the sense of his presence not to crowd out your understanding, but allow yourself to draw near to him, that you might hear his voice, that you might sense his presence. That day when I was in that youth conference, I was not worshiping God, right? And the whole room was going crazy. The music was loud, smoke machines, you know what youth conferences are like. But I heard him. I sensed him. Even in a broken place, I'd learned to hear his voice. Maybe today is the first time you're ever going to hear his voice. Maybe you're sitting here today thinking, I'm only here because they brought me. I'm only here because I got dragged here today. You know what? I don't even know why I'm here. But actually, you know what? I'm going to give this God a go. Maybe you'll speak to me. Maybe the light of the world, the creator and sustainer of all life on earth, wants a relationship with me. God is here and he's in this house, you know. He's a powerful God, a mighty God. One day God's great light will expose all of the darkness and the brokenness and all of the deep, dark recesses of the human heart. God will expose the deeds that have been done by mankind unto judgment, but that's not what he wants. That's not what he longs for. He wants to know, are you ready to meet with him? Are you ready to come home to your God? Are you ready to allow the Lord himself to fulfill every desire of your heart as he reveals himself to you? Again, God calls out to you today, through Jesus Christ, come to me. Come to me. Just come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, all of you that have become aware of your sinful state, all of you that have become aware of the darkness that exists in humanity, all of you are sick and tired of being sick and tired of being sick and tired of the pain and the suffering that this world constantly throws at you. Jesus promises that in this life, you will have trouble. As surely as the sparks fly upwards, says the Bible, man is born into trouble. But there is a God who will walk with you through it, a God who is here and is in this house and longs for a relationship with you. I remember another time being at another youth conference, and this time I was there with my young people, and I didn't really have much of a job to do other than keep an eye on them, make sure they're okay. And this girl from my Bible college, she came running over to me. She goes, Ash, quick, please come and help me. There's a young lad who's come to the prayer tent. I'm volunteering in the prayer tent. This young lad's come. He's about 14, 15, and he's just broken. He's just huddled up in the corner of the room. He's weeping, and he's crying, and he's bawling. And I don't even know what to do. And so I was like, okay, cool, I'll come. And so I did what I always do. The lights are blaring, the sounds are going off, and I'm just like, Lord, please, what do you want to say, Lord? What's going on? Help me to understand. What am I going to encounter when I get there? I didn't hear anything. God wasn't speaking to me. And I got to this prayer tent, and sure enough, there was a lad there, and chavvy looking lads with the man bags on and all the rest of that. He was kind of literally huddled up in the corner, head in his arms, bawling and weeping. You could hear him audibly over the music, just crying and weeping and wailing. And I was like, Lord, I don't know what to do. So I sat next to him and I just kept my mouth shut, and I'm trying to hear God, and this kid's crying, like bawling, and I'm like, what do I do? So compassion overwhelms you, right? So I put my hand on his shoulder and I said, are you okay? Pray for you. And he just stopped, and you could see him fighting back the tears, and he looked up at me. He says, I'm forgiven. It's all over. I'm forgiven. I can't believe it. I don't have to be ashamed. I'm forgiven. And again, tears overwhelmed, and he began to bawl and to cry and to weep. This kid met with God. He met with the judge of all mankind. He had been carrying his sin and his shame. He had been carrying this darkness, this, whatever it was. He didn't need me to pray. He'd met with God. He didn't need my wise words at that moment. He was in the presence of Almighty God, and he was overwhelmed with the love of God, and tears were flowing down his face. Our God is an incredible God. He's here. He's in this house. And we ask, my Lord, in Jesus' name, that you would move in power in this place, that you would touch lives in this place, Lord God, that the manifestation of your presence would be physical and it would be tangible in Jesus' name. Just as I come to the last part of what I'm going to say here today, the Bible declares that the same power that raised Christ Jesus from death to life is the same power that exists in those of us who put our trust in Jesus Christ. In fact, the Bible, you know what, it goes a step further. It says that our God can do immeasurably more than all that we ask, think, or even imagine, according to the power of God that's at work within us. The Bible says that Jesus was the visible representation of the invisible God. That all of the attributes find themselves in Almighty God. They find themselves in Jesus Christ. That as he walked the face of the earth, you can see the face of God. People often say to me, but I can't see God. How can I believe in him? I tell them, look, just spend enough time in the Gospels, and I promise you, through Jesus, you will stare into the face of Almighty God. You want to know your God? Join Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John as they reveal him to you. Jesus walked this earth, healing lepers, opening the eyes of the blind, restoring the sound to the people's ears. He himself healing and blessing and loving, revealing the love of Almighty God through the power of God to raise and to save and to bless and to redeem. And our God, that same God, is in this house right here, right now. I first met God myself 10 years ago. I was in prison, believe it or not, serving a sentence for ABH, witness intimidation and possession of drugs. I was a broken down gangster, a wannabe gangster, a drug addict, a thug, a career criminal, brokenness, darkness, pain, disruption, depression, anxiety, the whole lot here gripped me. I was firmly in Satan's grip. And one day as I walked down the corridor in a prison wing, I met with Almighty God. That's right, my God was in prison and he came looking for me. He revealed himself to me powerfully. He set me free from addiction. I didn't go to rehab. I didn't have any counselors or referral. I didn't need none of that. The power of God met with me. Through him revealing himself, amen. Praise God. Since being set free from addiction and a life of career criminality, I've been a youth worker for the last 8 years. I've been to university. I've got a first class honors in my degree. I've got married to this incredibly beautiful woman. I'm a trainee church minister. That's the power of my God. And he's still here now. He's still in this house. He's still changing lives. He's still restoring the lost to being found. God is in the business of saving souls. He's here. And the reason he's here and the reason he can do this is through the divine exchange. You ever heard of the divine exchange? My Bible declares that he who knew no sin, he himself became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ. That Jesus, at the end of his beautiful, impeccable, perfect, holy life, displaying the glory of Almighty God, he was abandoned into the grave, betrayed by his friends. He was sentenced to death by the religious people, and the Roman Empire crucified him. This is our God. This is how much he does not want to judge. This is how much he wants to redeem and to save and to set free. That he's willing to go to the cross on your behalf. He's willing to die in your place, so that through faith in Jesus Christ, you might be redeemed. The true power of Almighty God is found in the person of Jesus Christ. You want to see God? You want to be filled with light and life and liberty? You need the righteousness of God through Jesus Christ in your inner being. The power of God is amongst us. I think it'd be right to maybe go into a song, a bit of praise, a bit of worship, and then if you're up for going to just be pause and still and see what God does, huh? Should we praise our God? Do you want to stand to your feet?
Take the lead, mate.
See, the message of the cross, that of a divinely powerful, almighty God, displaying a radical form of redemptive love in a crucified Christ. Even God's weak day was still strong enough to overpower all the powers of hell. Here today, you can leave your darkness behind, you can leave your sin behind, and you can receive the grace of God in Jesus Christ. Let's for a moment, let's just worship him. Let's fix our eyes back on the Lord. And as the music comes to a quiet, as the music comes to a still, I'm just going to pray a simple prayer. Lord Jesus, come. And then if you're willing and you're able, and you've got the time, let's just pause and be still. Let's see what he does, eh? Amen.
We call you way make, miracle work, promise keeper. Sorry. Miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah. Way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yeah. Way make, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Sing it over your situation, hallelujah. Way maker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Yeah. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Father, you are the way maker, you're the miracle worker, the holy, mighty, righteous, honorable God, my Lord God. Lord Jesus, would you come? My Lord, we wait on you, my Lord God. We wait on you. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.
You are here.
You are here. Moving in the midst,
I worship you. I worship you. You are here,
working in this place.
I worship you.
I worship you. You are here moving.
You are here.
He's here, and he's moving in the midst.
I worship you. I worship you. You are here,
working in this place.
I worship you.
I worship you. We come,
we make a miracle work. Promise keep,
light in the darkness.
My God, that is who you are.
Yeah.
We make a miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Way maker.
We make a miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. We make a miracle work, promise
keep, light in the darkness, my God,
that is who you are.
Yeah, my Lord, we just pray, come Holy Spirit, your people. There's some of you here who are already beginning to sense the presence of God. Some of you here who felt him the moment that you came in, and his presence has been increasing ever since you've been here. Been inviting him in, you've been open to this message, and he's meeting with you already. Just as we're still, just as we're pausing right now, I just ask, Lord Jesus, that you would increase your presence in this house. But for those who are sensing you right now, for those who of you, us here who are encountering you right now, would you continue to come? Would you give them words of revelation, words of knowledge, words of understanding? Would you give them pictures, Lord God? Would you speak to your servants, Lord God? Would you come, Holy Spirit?
Yeah, I had two pictures, really. The first one was like, it's like of a person, but they were covered in like a kind of a shroud, almost like a metallic thing, like would be in a science fiction movie or something. They were moving. You knew it was a person inside, a little slit for the eyes. They were moving, but they were completely protected by this metal casing around them, because they'd become so fearful of life and of people that they were able to move about, but nothing could reach, nothing could touch them. They weren't connecting with anybody. They were just living. They were just moving forward, but they were not connecting. They were so frightened. And it's like as if they didn't have arms. They didn't have legs. But, you know, God is saying, you do have arms. You do have legs. Jesus Christ came that you might have life, and life in abundance. And God will lift that fear and that self-protectiveness off of you today. And you will engage with life again. you know who you are if there's that person's in this meeting. And the other one is a bit of a strange one. You know those teeter-totters, I guess you call them seesaws here. I'm bilingual, I can't remember which is American, which is English. Teeter-totters and seesaws. So if you get two kids on one of those, and one of them, you know, is on the ground, and they're like, instead of pushing up, they leave the other person hanging up in the air. And they're kind of doing it because they're like angry with them. They're just leaving them hangry. And I believe it's about a relationship. And this is not about the person who's feeling left up in the air. This word is for the person who's keeping someone up in the air, and that's unkind, and God wants you to stop doing that. That's it. If it's in someone in this room, then I pray it'll speak to you.
We want to give some chance for people who want to receive prayer. For those of you who've sensed the presence of God, I'd encourage you to come forward. Oftentimes God will, like he did with me, just breathe gently until you recognize his presence, until you reach out for a bit more, and then the full revelation of why he's meeting with you will become apparent. For the others of you in the room who aren't feeling God, don't be afraid, don't be worried. It's not because God doesn't love you. I don't particularly feel God today, because my job is not to feel God. My job is to encourage people to meet with God, right? Amen. But God meets with us in different ways, in different seasons, for different purposes. And God is here, and he's in the house. So if anybody wants to come forward for prayer, if anybody wants to leave their seats and come forward and just acknowledge, you know what, God's doing something with me. I'm just sensing him. I want more. Then this space is open for you as well. And also, if any of those prophetic words spoke to, I'd encourage you to come and speak to Ted. To come and speak to Ted, okay?
You know what I just want to say as well? I think that, those words up there then, light in the darkness. I feel like that's quite prophetic for what's been shared today.
You wipe away your tears, you mend the broken heart, you're the answer to it all, Jesus. You wipe away your tears, you mend the broken heart, you're the answer to it all, Jesus. You wipe away your tears, you mend the broken heart, you're the answer to it all, Jesus. You wipe away your tears, you mend the broken heart, you're the answer to it all, Jesus. And even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, he's working. Even when you don't feel it, he's working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when you don't feel it, he's working. And even when you don't see it, he's working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when you don't see it, he's working. And even when you don't feel it, he's working. He never stops working. He never stops. He never stops working. Even when you don't see it, he's working. And even when you don't feel it, he's working. He never stops. He never stops working. He never stops. Never stops.
Waymaker, miracle worker,
promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Yeah.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You know, the Lord will keep inviting, and he'll keep prophetic words, he'll keep giving words of knowledge and words of wisdom, because he wants to invite you to meet with him. He's a communal God, right? And where two or three are gathered together, he's surely there in our midst. I always feel him more when I'm amongst my brothers and sisters, right? I just got a bit of a sense of that someone in here is struggling with anxiety. Now, that's not a prophetic word. In a room this size, there's always going to be someone, right? So that's not pretty prophetic, right? However, at that moment when I talked about darkness, about God separating the light from the dark, and that God wants to expose the darkness in our lives, as I spoke those words, that person has this anxiety. They suddenly felt exposed. They were sitting there thinking, I don't want that, I don't even want to go there. And they were suddenly reminded of their anxiety. And then as we came towards the end of this message, I began to talk about the judgment of God. They were feeling judged by God. They weren't particularly feeling his light and his love. And I think God is, even now as he's highlighting this, you're thinking, just keep away from me, don't even mention my name, I don't want you drawing any attention to me. God wants to just touch you softly and gently. And he's not asking you to come to the front because he knows that's just not your thing. But he wants you to just touch space with someone before you leave. Someone in here that you trust. Someone in here that you know has your best interests at heart, and then all they're going to do is pray for you. They're not going to ask you about it. They're not going to press in. They're not going to pray. They're just going to ask God to meet with you personally, okay? I think, Ted, have you got a word as well?
It was about someone with a dental problem with a lot of pain in their mouth, and they were going to need, they're being told they need deep excavation. What do you call it? Root canal work. But God says that he will heal you today, and you'll know that you're healed. You really will be healed, and you won't need it.
So again, the invitation's here. If anybody wants prayer for anything in particular, if there's a dark situation in their lives, you don't have to go into it too much. If you just want prayer for anything, again, we're here to pray with you, all right? God bless everyone. And I'll hand the room back over to Stephen now anyway. God bless. Go on, Kobe.
So Psalm 103 says, it says, praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who forgives all your sins. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who heals your diseases. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who redeemed your life from the pit. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who forgives all your sins. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who heals all your diseases. Praise the Lord, oh my soul, who redeemed your life from the pit. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. The Lord is good. The Lord is merciful and kind. The Lord is here. The Lord is here for you. The Lord is good. He's good. He's your healer, restorer, deliverer, and friend. He's your healer, restorer, deliverer, and friend. He's your healer, restorer, deliverer, and friend. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We will praise you, Lord.
yourself. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just stay in this atmosphere right now. Is there any problem when I'm leading worship? I've got less people at the front here. Now we need to set up a prayer ministry team, I think. If you're new here, this is a church plant, by the way. There's lots of space for you to emerge as leaders in this church. But Ash, absolutely incredible. You know what one thing I love about Ash's ministry is? He's got the power of the Spirit, but he's got a head full of theology as well. And you know, theology, sometimes it can be liberal, sometimes it can be, you know, like political. You know, Ash's theology is biblical. And that's what we're about in this church. We're not a normal Pentecostal church. We're not all like full of the Spirit and no truth. You know, we follow the Word and the Spirit because we believe that's when revival's going to come, when the Word and Spirit unite. And so, you know, you really do carry the heart of the restoration. You embody the restoration way. So, you know, we do thank you for your ministry. You know, one thing I really believe, if I can sum up Ash's sermon in one statement or phrase, is this. Many people want the power of God, amen? We want the power of God. We want revival. We want Pentecost again, yeah? Well, if you want Pentecost, are you willing to die for lying to the Holy Spirit? You see, that's what happened in Pentecost, isn't it? We usually think, oh yeah, God's great in the New Testament. You know, there's no judgment, there's no wrath, there's just love, there's just gift of tongues, there's power, there's healings and all that lot. But I remember in the book of Acts, actually, Ananias and Sapphira died for lying to the Holy Spirit. And I think that's what Ash is saying here. If we want the power of God, if we want more of God in our lives, then we need more holiness, more righteousness as well. You can't have one without the other. What fellowship does darkness have with light? Amen. And I really believe that's what he's saying today. Now what we're going to do is we're going to thank you so much for your ministry, brother. It was an excellent word. I loved it. I loved how you tied it in with you know, what the liberals are saying and all that sort of stuff, making it really relevant to our day and context. And there's something there for everyone, isn't there? If you like philosophy, if you like theology, there's something there. If you're more experiential and you like the power, there's something there. But we're going to carry on in this atmosphere right now. What we're going to do is we're going to take communion together now. Our brother Festo is going to come up and serve the communion, if that's okay, brother. And what we're going to do is we're going to break up into groups and we're going to pursue what Ash has been ministering on. We're going to pursue that in groups together, pray for one another. Last time we did this a few weeks ago, God really moved powerfully, yeah? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump on the guitar, me and Chloe. We're going to continue to carry on just leading you in some worship, just ever so gently, singing over you while you guys engage in prayer. Does that work for everybody? Are we all willing? I don't know about you, I'm an introvert. Whenever you say break off into groups, I just think, oh, I was happy just sit here listening to you. But now let's do that then. Let's if you want to come forward, Brother Festo. Festo's going to come round with the communion. I'll get up on the guitar. We'll play some worship as unto the Lord. And then just be thinking about now two or three people who I could get together with now to pray, break bread and pray together. Let me just administer the communion before we do that, because I know last time I forgot to and then it was a bit awkward. I don't want to be interrupting your prayers. Hallelujah. It's always weird, isn't it, when you're looking through someone else's Bible, you can't seem to find your place as easy. So this is what the Apostle Paul said in relation to the Lord's Supper, the cup of the new covenant. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Lord Father, we pray and come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we ask, Lord, that we would know your power and your presence through these emblems that represent, Lord, your broken body and your shed blood on our behalf. Lord, we pray, Father, that we'll be healing now, Father. Experience, Lord, in this sacrament of Holy Communion. Father, we ask, Father, that you would touch us, Lord, afresh, that we would know the unity of the Spirit, that we would encounter Jesus Christ through his body, through the emblems, and through one another in this time of praying together. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much, Lord. What Ash shared there, absolutely correct. The attributes of God, you can't view one in separation to the other. It's the mercy of God means nothing without the power of God. And so, Lord, this communion represents your power displayed and invested into us. And Father, as we come to remember you now and your merciful act and gracious act of sending your only Son to die in our place, the Son of God, who was always with the Father in eternity past, was separated from God on the cross. He felt separated. The Son experienced that feeling of darkness, of separation, so that we could be brought near. Father, we pray as we take this time now to focus upon what Jesus Christ has done in our lives at the cross of Calvary, that we would know everything, Lord, experience everything of what he died to bring. In Jesus' name.
Free to break up into groups. Try and choose someone who you don't really know. Let's try and look like, you know, if you're here with your family, don't just pray and take communion with your family. Although you can do if you want. Family is really important, you know. But, you know, let's be the church, guys. Let's break bread together. That's what they did in the New Testament, amen. And let's pray together, yeah. This is a safe space. This is the church. You can bring your burdens to one another. It's actually what we're commanded to do in the scripture. Be high and lifted up, be high and lifted up, be high and lifted up, Jesus. It's you we glorify, it's you we're lifting high, your name be glorified. Be high and lifted, be high and lifted up, be high and lifted up, be high and lifted up, Jesus.
You Ted.
Lift in high, your name be glorified. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are worthy of our
lifted up. Be high and lifted up. Be high and lifted up. Jesus, it's you we glorify. It's you we lifting high. Your name be glorified. Be high and lifted. Be high and lifted up. Be high and lifted up. Be high and lifted up. Jesus, it's you we glorify. It's you we lift in high. Your name be glorified. Upon a rock, now I know I love you, I need you. And though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, and I will worship you until the very end. He is glorified, forever He is lifted high, forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive, forever He is glorified. We sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. The Lord has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. For the Lord has overcome. You've overcome, my King.
Overcome.
Overcome, my God, you've overcome, you've overcome, my Lord.
Jesus, we thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Jesus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. If you're praying, just keep praying. We don't want to interfere with what the Lord is doing. Hallelujah. We're just going to take a moment to take our tithe and our offering. If you're new here, if you're a guest this morning, please don't feel obligated to give. But tithing is something, giving is something that we do as Christians. We give to the church, to the body, to this particular family. We share, we have everything in common. What's mine is yours, what's yours is mine. Paul says that, you know, he loves a cheerful giver. It's good for us to give, amen. It fills our hearts with joy. You know, it's good to overcome our selfishness, our sinfulness by giving, you know. So if you're new here this morning, please don't feel obligated to give. But if you are a part of this church, a part of this family, and a part of this community, then this would be a moment now where you can just give your tithing, your offering. Brother Festo is going to come around with the basket. Let me just pray for this this offering this morning. Father, we want to give you praise and thanks, Lord, that you have given us content hearts, Lord, that you have declared us innocent because of the cross of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Father God, that you've given us a heart of thankfulness, Lord, abounding in praise and worship, Lord. And part of that praise, Lord, is not just to worship with our mouths, but to worship with our deeds and, in fact, with our wallets. And so, Lord, we give you this offering this morning, Father, as a sacrifice in worship to you, Father, knowing that the promise of Scripture is that, Lord, if we give to you, Lord, you will make sure that we are lacking nothing, Lord. You will give a hundredfold back, the Bible says. So, Lord, we declare our trust in you, our faith in you, Lord, with our finances. And, Lord, we give this money to you as an offering and a sacrifice. We pray, Lord, use it for your glory and for your purpose and for the furtherance of your kingdom, Lord, to impact and bless our city and our nation with the glorious kingdom of God declared in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I think Brother Festo is going to pass that basket around. Amen. Praise God. And just one announcement before we finish. We're going to go through for coffee now and tea and cake. We've got lovely homemade cake by Janet. Come on. Right, I'm ready for a piece of that. Janet, I didn't have no breakfast this morning. I didn't have no breakfast this morning just to save a spot for some nice homemade cake. So you want to get a piece of that, guys. And guess what? It's all free, yeah? The church is a non-profit organisation. Amen. We're here to bless you. But, yeah, we've got an announcement to make. If I could just have everyone's attention, 1 second. If we could just get everyone's attention, just 1 second. Just 1 sec, bro. Yeah, I think we've got it up on the screen there. Just an announcement. Very, very big announcement for you this Sunday. This summer, we've really had an amazing opportunity just thrown on our laps by God. This summer we're going to be having Jesus Fields come to Restoration Church in July, and that's going to be made up of all those guest speakers there. We're going to have Dominic Muir come, who's got an incredible prophetic evangelistic mission at ministry. We're going to have Daniel Chand, who's going to join us for that weekend as well. It's going to be like basically a 5-day mission. And we're going to have Jonathan Conrath, who's seen hundreds of thousands, or is it millions? I can't even remember. But like, he's seen, like, honestly, these guys have got global ministries, right? Jonathan Conrath and Daniel Chan both move in signs, wonders, and miracles ministry. So it's going to be incredible. And we're going to have Yinka Oikan, I think, if I pronounce his name right, and he did something with the turning as well. These guys have been on TBN, not that TV really matters, but you know, these guys are big ministries. We're really blessed. Like, this opportunity just came on our lap.
that, you know, Domi had all these guys booked out for 1 week, and the locations that they wanted to do it in, they were just blockages. So then I was talking to Dom, and he was like, listen, guys, I've got all these evangelists all booked out for 1 week. It'd be a shame to waste them. Could we not do something in Oxford? I was like, boy, you bet we can. So we prayed about it for a weekend, and it's happening, guys. We're going to be renting the field out, hopefully, if the terms everything's okay with the council. We're going to be doing a festival on the field just down the road there. There's going to be training and equipping in the church during the weekdays. And then in the evenings, we'll be having evangelistic, crusade, basically, over there in the field. So it's going to be incredible. Guys, so what I want to say is, book that. If you want to know the dates, I can get the dates to you. But at the minute, we're just kind of putting a coming soon flyer out there just to put it on the agenda. We're going to need volunteers. But, you know, more importantly, last year we did a mission, right? It weren't as big as this. This is going to be big, right? Yeah. But the thing is, yeah, last time we were saying we need volunteers to help us with this mission. We do need volunteers. But more importantly, I'd like to see us as a church there to receive. Amen. Because do you know what? God's got something for you, man. And I think there's a lot of people in here who God wants to springboard you forward into. Amen. So, don't miss out on this opportunity. This is going to be incredible. We're going to see Oxford saved. Amen. All them in 1 week. I don't think Oxford's ready. Amen. Come on. Do you want to just come up and share just quickly?
Went to London to see Daniel Chan. He's an absolutely amazing man of God. And while we were there, there was healing. I remember one young girl went up. She had her hand, something was wrong with her hand, and he healed her from that. I think she's only about 12. So yeah, Daniel Chan, amazing. And we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. So yeah.
Yeah, man, it's going to be incredible, mate. I love Dom because he's really got the same heart as this church as well. He's really up for, you know, being a prophetic voice to the secularism and all the cultural chaos that we find around ourselves. But he's a very strong evangelist as well. And do you know what? This is going to be an incredible week. So please, there's three ways you can support this. I don't really want you to support it, really. I want you to receive. I want you to get there. And I want you to get your socks blessed off, man, yeah? But I want you to get healed, Marion. We're believing for your healing, amen. It's going to be an incredible week. But what I want to say is this. Three ways you can support this. Pray, first and foremostly. If you can volunteer in any way, shape or form, we're going to need stewards. We're going to need catering and everything like that. And then another way you can support it is simply by being there, man. Yeah, let's be there. Let's be the church. And let's, do you know what? These guys are going to train and equip you. There's going to be training on moving in the miraculous, how to receive words of knowledge, how to heal the sick and how to cast all that stuff. It's going to all be trained and equipped into you. There's going to be all sorts of practical things as well as supernatural things. So it's a time for you to be equipped, sent out as the church. And do you know what? That gas man, yeah, he got saved this week, yeah? Come on, man. I mean, we all want to know that, don't we? It's an amazing thing to lead someone to the Lord, man, honestly. You get a right buzz off of God for that, you know? Because all heaven rejoices. Amen. Okay, Father, we want to give you praise and thanks, Lord, for the great things that you are about to do, Father. No eye has seen, no ear has heard what the great things the Lord has in store for those who love him. You're able to do far abundantly more than all we can begin to ask, think, or imagine, according to Jesus Christ. So, Lord, increase our faith, stretch our expectations, Lord, and cause us to believe for great and big things from you, God, things that could never be done in the natural, because you're a supernatural God. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. And Lord, bless us this week as we go about our business, kingdom business, in Jesus' name. Amen.